Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Our meeting will now come to order. Let's bow for our invocation, please. Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord, and we just ask, Lord, that you bless this meeting tonight and just help us to discern what needs to be done tonight so that we will be fair and square to all the people of the citizens of Alamance County. Lord, forgive us of our sins and just watch over us and guide us as we go through this meeting. Amen.
Amen.
Next thing is public comments. Mr. Shue is first. And we do ask that the public comments be 3 minutes. And Ms. Hook over here is who times the people on that, so she is our human resources. Okay.
Good evening, Madam Chairman.
Good evening.
At the last meeting, the chair lady made a point of saying these meetings would be run by the rules. So I guess what I'm to keep within the rules, I'm asking is a couple of points of inquiry of the chair. Is not a point of order allowed when a speaker is interrupted by a board member or assembly member to pose a question and interject a comment before the speaker yields? Or is a point of privilege the more correct format for that type of a situation? And my second point of inquiry would be, are the gathered interested members of the public considered part of this meeting or assembly or whatever you'd like to call it? That'd be two questions I pose to the chair.
Okay. Well, I don't have my book to read the exact rule. If you'll give it to me, that's fine. Where did you get that one from?
I wrote that. So
you know what it was. Oh, okay. Well, I'll get back with you on this, okay? Yeah. And the members of the public are certainly part of the assembly.
Okay.
Okay. Next is Mr. Ken Walker.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
I'm Ken Walker. I just came to introduce myself. I'm the acting chairman of the Alamance County Planning Board. I came here tonight to be available if you had any questions or comments regarding the noise ordinance that we're bringing back before you tonight. And, just want to avail myself to be here.
We're glad you came.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Next is Bill Smith.
Hey, Ms. Madison, how y'all doing tonight?
Good.
I'm Bill Smith. I got a couple questions. Won't take but a minute.
That's all right.
Asked about the missing money from the tax office. What's the status on that? It's got quiet. Nobody knows anything. Nobody's saying anything.
Mr. Britt, can you address that?
Yes, ma'am.
Since the sheriff department has that.
Yes, ma'am. And we have a current investigation at the request of the county manager and county staff and board of commissioners. We requested the SBI to be involved. They have assigned their diversion unit out of Raleigh, which is their accountants and agents, and they are currently investigating that. We are getting reports regularly and working with Mr. Albright through the legal staff to go through that. There's quite a bit of material that has to be gone through forensically.
In other words, it's still active, it's not dying.
Absolutely. Okay. Yes, sir, absolutely. We're right. Currently still in that.
That's what I want to know. I quit hearing anything about it.
Okay.
I don't want that to die.
We don't want to die either. We are certainly on top of that.
Okay. Next question I got, won't take but a minute for it.
Okay.
How about the overpayments that was made and the help she had in messing up the county tax appraisal?
Well,
that's that. You don't hear anything about that?
Well, now,
our
tax administrator spoke last week, and that is also, Mr. Albright, would you address that, please?
Sure. We're continuing with our discovery in that case. We took the tax administrator's deposition on September 11th, and we're proceeding down the path in that case. And we're planning to depose the head of RS&M.
It's still alive.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Thank you,
We're
ma'am.
We're not going to let that night, Mr. Smith.
Okay, I'm going.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you. No, we're on top of that, so. Next is Karen LaShaw. LaShaw, I got it right, okay.
Got it. Now, Chair, my name is Karen LaShaw, and I am a representative of a group in Swepsonville, Saxbahaw area that would like to speak to the noise ordinance. And I don't know if this is the proper time to do that or not. I've got a very short thing I'd like to read, if that's okay with y'all.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. My subject tonight is the county noise ordinance. All property owners have the right to use their property to their benefit, but they do not have the right to interfere with how their neighbors enjoy their own personal property. Sounds and loud noises do not respect property boundaries. This is partly why neighbors need to respect their neighbors. Most of the time, this neighborly respect works great. That is because we are usually talking about noises and sounds that people in the county expect to hear. Sounds like tractors and fans and chickens and cows and sounds of hunting and target practice, an occasional motorboat, chainsaws, lawn mowers, blowers, construction equipment, even loud cars, barking dogs, and the lesser noises of trees, frogs, and crickets. Many of these sounds have natural cycles following the sun, and many of these man-made sounds follow common sense cycles, starting after sunrise and ending shortly after sunset. Country living is wonderful and especially serene when the peace and quiet are allowed to be just that, peace and quiet. Examples of when a neighbor is not being too neighborly include operating a racetrack or a motorcycle track after dark. While your neighbor can operate a racetrack, very few people want to hear loud engines after dark when children should be sleeping peacefully and when families are trying to enjoy an evening meal. A similar example of not being a good neighbor is when a group of people get together to enjoy music after hours. It is one thing to enjoy music in your home or in an enclosed auditorium, but when that music is played outside using today's amplifying stereo and speaker systems, it too easily crosses property boundaries. The noise disrupts the otherwise tranquil and peaceful atmosphere that many families associate with country living. I and many others are not against outdoor events or for-profit endeavors, but we would like other residents, and businesses to respect our privacy and our desire to live in a peaceful, relaxing country environment. We would like to request that clear guidelines are established for businesses and events that generate noise conditions that cross property boundaries within the county. We would recommend that Sunday through Thursday have time limits such as 9 p.m. to 8 a.m. quiet time. We would also recommend that the county should Sunday, Friday, and Saturday could be extended to 10 p.m. to 8 a.m. for quiet hours. We would also recommend that the county should consider a formal permitting process in advance of the business setup or event date so that the local authorities, including the sheriff, could properly assess the potential impact and prepare appropriate responses. Being a good neighbor includes being respectful of your neighbors. Being a good community leader includes establishing guidelines that reinforce common sense expectations for our high quality country living lifestyle here in Alamance County. I look forward to return of a more peaceful and tranquil environment in our countryside with your help.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Beverly Kerr.
Hey, ma'am. I'm Beverly Kerr, and I'm here to talk to you about the noise ordinance. I'm really concerned that all businesses are exempt, and I hope that you will really reconsider this. Businesses should be regulated as well as private homes. And I would like to ask a question as to, we talked about using decibels to measure sound, and I thought that there were several people on the planning board and maybe even a commissioner and the sheriff's department who thought that was a reasonable idea. And I wondered why that went away, why there was no discussion of it. A lot of the other counties use that, and it seems like a good idea to me. Looking at the noise ordinance now, it says normal sounds associated with normal course of business. That's pretty generic. I have a business that's beside my property, and their sound is not normal, and it needs to be checked. And the only thing I can think of is to use the decibel meter to determine the sound. So can I ask about that, the decibel meter, why that went away, why it wasn't discussed and addressed?
We'll let Mr. Martin address that. But I will tell you that we have been to South Atlantic. Mm-hmm. Actually, Mr. Boswell, myself, and Ann have been to South Atlantic.
Wonderful.
And I did sit at the highway.
Mm-hmm.
For several, quite a while with my car shut down, and I could not hear anything down there. All I could hear was road noise. So I probably sat the first day at least 10 minutes, and I even rode down by your house,
mm-hmm.
and sat down at that little service station down there, or put in gas, whatever. And I will tell you that I could not hear anything whatsoever, and I do know the trees are a good buffer. At this point.
Well, if they were operating, you would have heard them.
Well, they were.
They were.
They were.
Yeah,
they were operating. And it was, but even in the plant area, I mean, unless they dropped a big piece of steel, it was not that noisy. I didn't think it was that noisy. That's my opinion.
At that time,
yes, ma'am. Okay.
Well,
and I went twice.
I appreciate you going. That means a lot to me that you took the time to go and check it out. And thank you for letting me speak.
But if you will call me,
mm-hmm.
When you feel like that it's too loud, I will come to your house.
Would you?
I will.
Wonderful.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, that was the other thing that here it says, in the event any person has reasonable grounds for believing that this is being violated, again, this is very generic. I believe that we have reasonable grounds. I think it needs to be clearer.
Like I said, if you'll call me, I'm in the book.
Okay.
And if you want my card, I'll give it to you before you leave.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sue Dayton.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you? My name is Sue Dayton. I'm an Alamance County resident, and I'm here tonight to comment on the proposed noise ordinance, the amendments that I've seen so far. And I too am a little concerned, I think, and discouraged that we haven't heard anything about the decibels issue. And that was also proposed by the Sheriff's Department, because, you know, when you read through the ordinance, what you see are, you see it's very subjective. Blowing horns, radios, stereos, whistles, and there's absolutely no way to enforce blowing whistles or loud noises. And so I know that I believe Jason or someone was going to look into the cost of the decibel meters. And I just want to say, I have an antique shop in Saxpahaw, and I would be more than happy to donate to a silent auction to help purchase, you know, some of these decibel equipment that we need in order to, you know, have this enforcement as a part of the noise ordinance. I want to thank you, Linda, for going out to Beverly's house. You're awesome. And I think that's just great that you went the extra mile to do that.
Mr. Boswell and Ms. Vaughn also went to South Atlanta.
Thank you. Thank you, the three of you. We appreciate it.
Our county manager also went, and
Jason
Martin mm-hmm. also went there
okay.
with us too.
So. And I can assure you that there are huge loud noises. I've heard them myself when I've been over at Beverly's house before, you know, during the night. And it's been in the evening, huge crashing noises of tons of steel metal. Whoosh, you know, going into these vats, you know, being released. And it's incredible. It really is. And so maybe, hopefully, we can get y'all out there.
We saw the whole operation. Mm-hmm. It was running.
They were actually dipping.
Okay.
They were dipping. They were doing everything.
Well, hopefully, we can get y'all out there when you know, during a noisy night. Maybe we can have a popcorn party or something. But anyhow, go trick-or-treating. And in terms of businesses being exempt, I know this is a tough issue because of our zoning laws, the way things are set up, but there must be something that can be done here. There must be something, some type of mediation, you know, with businesses operating around the clock, you know, if we all put ourselves for a minute in the place of someone like Beverly Kerr, you know, with an industry that moved in, unbeknownst to her at the time, that is very disruptive, and not only with noises, but chemicals coming onto her property, which is a whole other issue. You would see the need, you know, for some changes. So, thank you for your time, and I appreciate it.
And we will have Mr. Martin address.
All right, very good. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay. At this time, we'll close the public comments, and this time we will open the public hearing on the noise ordinance. Mr. Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have enclosed in your packets a memorandum that summarizes the changes to the noise ordinance, as well as a highlighted draft of the ordinance, and again, a copy of the ordinance as it stands, the current one that's being enforced. And I did try to put these in an order that were a little bit easier to follow this time. I hope that helped. Of course, from the last from the meeting on September the 8th, I was directed to take this ordinance back to the planning board based on some of the comments that were made in the room that night. And I think there was a general consensus of with regards to hunting animals, pets, noises from pets. Also, the special events permit was a point of contention that evening. And then also farming operations, the language of bona fide farming. Basically, just to summarize what we have, Section 6B2, which is on page 2 of the ordinance, we've added language under number 2, radios and stereos, and that is adding hours between 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. and delineating that to Sunday through Thursday, or 12 a.m. and 6 a.m. Friday and Saturday. Under that same section, B3, which had originally had pets, we have struck that completely from the ordinance. On page 4, under section 7, exceptions, number 3, we've struck the language bona fide from farming operations. And then section 10, which included the special events permit, we have taken that out completely as well, which of course will cause the numbering to change. And I have prepared a clean copy of the ordinance as well, should you all choose to vote on that this evening. That does have all the numbering correct in the ordinance. The ordinance was taken to the planning board at their regular meeting on September the 10th, that fall at Thursday night. And the planning board did make these recommendations by unanimous vote. And I noticed that Chairman Walker is here this evening as well, who may be able to help answer any questions from the planning board standpoint. And there's also a few other planning board members in the room I'd like to recognize. I saw Jeff Slaughter, who is a planning board member, and also Rhett Davis is around here somewhere, is a planning board member as well. But that being said, I will be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
Can you answer the question on the decibel?
With the decibel meters?
Yes, sir.
Yes. I did not bring the information yet. At the last meeting, I had some information regarding the cost of decibel meters. And the there was initially talk of decibel levels and decibel meters, and I think there was a general understanding after consulting with both the county manager and with the sheriff's department that the costs that were involved with that would be rather extensive, pretty much anywhere between $250, $350 for meters that are designed for this type of measurement, all the way up to around $800. Also, those meters, too, we spoke about this again at the last planning board meeting, and I would invite my planning board members also if they wish to speak on that. We discussed it again a little bit at the meeting because I know Ms. Kerr was at that meeting and expressed her concerns regarding that again. And it was discussed, too, that the meters, when you use a decibel meter, they have to be properly calibrated, similar to your speedometer in your car. And if they're not properly calibrated, how well would it stand up in court? The ability to prove that the meters are properly calibrated. I think that was something we concurred with the assistant county attorney at that meeting as well regarding that. And so those were some of the issues as to why decibel meters were not really looked at. And the other thing, like I said at the last commissioner's meeting when this ordinance was brought up, the other thing is where do you measure from, and the terrain that it's on, and the elevation, and the buffering that's around it, that sort of thing, because sound dies over distance. There's a mathematical formula for it. I don't know off the top of my head, but that makes it also difficult to measure. And it was just determined that what the sheriff's department has requested from us is guidance, something clear, something that designates what a violation is. Also, to have some enforcement in there that is not tied to criminal penalties necessarily. And so that's why we looked at this from a civil penalty approach. And I hope that answers the question there.
Okay. Is it Mr. Walker? Do you want to address anything at this point?
How do you, all so many other counties that use it, and the cost that you've given is minimal. I'll donate the money if you'll just do that. And where you measure from is at the end of the property.
Well, there are several counties that do that. One of them I had talked about before was New Hanover County. That is one. There are others in the state that do that. Another thing where they will do that when they measure is they will attach that to their zoning ordinances, too. I've noticed that, where there will be a set decibel level or a range of decibel levels for residential development and for industrial development. If the county were to look at something like that, my inclination would be to recommend looking at a flat level, something for all of them, because there is no countywide zoning. There's no zoning districts to attach that to. There are some things where it's a residential subdivision, and that's clear cut that it's residential, but there's not clear designations of where industrial development may go, where commercial development may go, and that sort of thing. So,
okay, at this time, I'll ask the commissioner's comments on that.
Tim, what exactly are you looking for as far as would that decimal indicator or meter help y'all any or cause you problems? What you thinking?
Certainly, as we spoke before, as an office, we don't have a position. That's the board's to choose. The problem we have with the current ordinance is it doesn't spell out anything clear. And we do, you see just a little bit tonight of what we deal with almost daily, involving noise complaints in the county. I actually looked at the call sheet before I come over here. We had three today. So it's a problem. Certainly, if you set decimals or you set clear guidelines at this or time frames, that will give our officers the ability to go out. And if there is a problem in the community or neighborhood, that we can address it through a civil penalty, and there's a process by doing it this way. There's an appeal process. The person that gets a citation doesn't like it, it gives it some enforcement ability. Hopefully we could go out and just talk to folks and say, look, this is a violation. It requires a warning to start with, and that may solve the problem. I think ultimately we want to be able to limit the number of calls,
Last meeting I was in here, we'd had well over 300 this year. That's a lot of gas. It's a lot of time for deputies to be out here. That maybe there's something we could resolve. So, not to answer your question, I think that's y'all's place or where you want to draw the line, and we will enforce the ordinance you give us.
Burlington had, they were talking these meters back when they were, you know, trying to monitor the traffic on Graham Hopedale Road, you know, the cars, the boom boxes and so forth. Do they use anything now?
But so when I retired 6 years ago, we've long since moved away from the decimeters.
Yeah.
I can't speak intelligently to that now because I'm not experienced in it. The ones we had, at least in those days, back technology, we had a lot of problems with the maintenance on them, that the accuracy levels and things of that nature. But we had not used them, and I've been retired 6 years now, but we had not had them some time when I retired then.
Yeah, my gut feeling was they'd done away with them, but I remember them talking about them and using them. I have another question about the Section 10 special event permits. How are we going to handle, for instance, a private party, outdoor music, where you know somebody's having a, you know, having a party and they've got a live band on their patio, or how is that going to be handled?
Well, I think the trade-off that was made with that was the extension on weekends that covered music, and that was basically the trade-off. And I think the special events permit, after speaking to several citizens that called me as well, I think there was a little misunderstanding on that, and that there was a thought that anytime somebody gets married, they got to come get a permit.
Yeah.
And that's not the case, by no means. What the purpose of that was to make the sheriff's department aware that there's a party going on here, they have a live band out there, and they're going to be going to a certain time. And, of course, I think a lot of the, and this is just me speaking on a personal level, I think a lot of things could be head off if you have a party just going to your neighbors and saying, yeah, I'm going to have a party, and we're going to cut it off at 11 o'clock tonight.
Yeah.
And that sort of thing. And by the way, you're welcome to come. That would probably head off a lot of these problems.
Yeah, that would work.
But the problem is, I believe you clearly showed, a lot of the complaints we get is music.
Yes.
And things like that. But to answer your question, that was the trade-off there, was to deal with that on a midnight, give it a midnight cutoff.
Are these time frames something you can work with?
Yes, sir. You would be amazed at the numbers of calls that we're getting between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. for loud music. That's loud music is the predominant complaint. And it's not that if I really strain, I can hear it. We have some pretty rough situations in the community, same places over and over.
And you've been 3 or 4 miles away from the city.
Yeah,
that's true.
I'm sorry, I guess I skipped protocol. I thought I came prepared with some comments tonight, and I thought that would take place during the hearing. I didn't sign up for comments before. But
I'll let you still make them, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. But I have somewhat of an issue with the time frame. And I'll use my notes. I've got several people depending on me. I'm George Bryan. I live in Hall River. Sent a letter to the commissioners about a week ago, and my community has a real problem with a bar in our neighborhood that has loud music on a regular basis. And since April, I've called the sheriff's department well in excess of 25 times. In the last 10 days, I've called 4 times. My house is over 150 yards away from this bar building. The music is played inside. My next door neighbor, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, he's on a trip, his home is 200 yards away from that building. I wouldn't call it music. What we hear is noise, because all we hear is the bass amplifier from the building. My windows shake, my walls shake. You can't hear your TV on a lot of nights, and you certainly can't have a conversation, and I'll be darned if you can sleep. The only positive thing I've seen from this, and I'll give my age away on this, but remember in the 50s and 60s, the hotels used to have vibrating beds? We have that. You don't have to put the quarters into slots like you did back then.
That's why we put time limits on it. especially on the weekends and the nights. It is a business.
And I can understand that if a person is having a private party or something, we're exposed to this 2 and 3 nights a week. And certainly it's a business, but doesn't a business owner have an obligation to the community to take steps to assure the peace and serenity of the community? It's a simple matter of adjusting the amplifiers. There are some nights when we don't hear any music whatsoever, and quite frankly, I don't know the owner of the place, but I think they snubbed their nose at us and the sheriff's department. Sheriff's deputies will be called out. They'll turn the music down 10 minutes after the deputy goes. They turn it right back up again. So what do? You call again. Saturday night when we called, deputy came out. They turned the music down. The deputy left. They opened up the door, yelled obscenities to the neighborhood, and then turned the music up.
Well, that's why we have the citations here, too.
But just
a minute. Yes, sir. Hold on. If you will, let Jason.
The exception that everybody is referring to is number 14 on page 4, and it states normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial or manufacturing operations.
It wouldn't include the bars.
One section speaks to businesses in general, but then I think the next section does make exceptions for industrial. And there again, we realize these people have a right to operate a business. That's not the point of contention. Certainly they do, but I don't think it's unreasonable to ask these people to operate that business and ensure that they're not disturbing other people in the neighborhood. Another part of the ordinance states that I believe an outside amplifier can't be used to carry noise carry in excess of 150 feet.
Right.
Now, what's reasonable for inside? Personally, I can't have my grandkids over anymore on weekends because they can't sleep with the noise. My next door neighbor's bought a white noise machine for his 2-year-old daughter to try to get her to sleep. But quite frankly, a lot of times they wind up going to stay with relatives, and it's just an untenable situation that doesn't seem to. We just don't seem to be able to get any relief on it after all this time. So. I just wanted to leave here tonight, hopefully, with the understanding that this noise ordinance in some form would help us overcome this situation. And in all honesty, if you had to live with it, if we got to sit there and listen to this music every Friday and Saturday night till midnight, by the time the sheriff's department's been great, the deputies, I could not ask for more professional people, have been great to work with, but by the time you wait until 12 o'clock, you call, it's going to take them from 20 to 40 minutes to get there. If these people don't pay attention to the deputy, turn the music back up again, it's like last Saturday night. We finally got to bed at 2 o'clock. And I have to work during the daytime. I do like to go to church on Sunday, and this is just a situation I don't think we should have to live with.
Well, that's why we put time on that side.
I'm trying to say is that the midnight I don't think is reasonable if it's an ongoing, recurring situation. If I'm having a party, sure, tell the neighbors and I'll understand.
Are you talking about the Oasis? Is that
yes, ma'am. The Oasis is.
Because they've been there for years and years and years and years.
They were not a problem when I moved there in 2007. Why, I don't know.
I don't know either.
I only began experiencing the problem in April.
Okay.
But to me, is it a matter of how long they've been there? I didn't see a sign when I moved in, don't move in this neighborhood because we got a bar down here that plays loud music. I'm sorry, I was from Nashville, Tennessee, and I didn't know it.
Right. Okay.
All I'm asking is for peace and quiet in our neighborhood.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening. I appreciate it.
Yes, Mr. Shue.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I hope that you're starting to see the problem with this ordinance. Now, Mr. Boswell and myself talked business. We were talking. I said, what if my neighbor, which actually happened, he was a mechanic. He came in. He had him a garage. He run a shop out there. All right, is Terry going out there and say, let me see your tax records to see if you're a business? I think this whole thing is too broad and too intrusive. It is, you ought to be able to see it, not to be derogatory towards the people that have spoke up, but you ought to be able to see this is that slippery slope to get two businesses. What business does the county have getting into businesses that people have maybe hobbies they have, say they're woodwork. You got 8 o'clock in there for some things. They're out there with a nail hammer. I mean, it's just too broad. A noise ordinance probably of some kind would be justified, but if you can't see that, you already can't satisfy me, you know, with this, there's still a lot of dissatisfaction. So why go to the effort with something that's broad that just opening up holes? I would urge you to vote against it. Just stick with old ordinance for now. If they come back with something that has a real leg to stand on, then vote for it. But I can understand people having problems, but this thing is real broad, full of holes. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Who else? Yes, sir. Hey, how are you?
Good evening, everyone.
And please state your name.
I am Darrell Russell, and I'm here to voice my support for the noise ordinance. And I probably wouldn't be here tonight except about 3 or 4 months ago, my neighbor built a dirt bike track. I don't know how many of y'all have ever been around a dirt bike that, I'm going to say, just doesn't have good mufflers on it. But whenever that thing is going up a ramp wide open, it's just my opinion, but that is the most irritating, obnoxious, and unnecessary noise that I think I've heard. So I support what the board is doing and trying to control noises. I know it's not easy. Some things are almost common sense that's just not right. Maybe having some teeth in the ordinance with some fines or whatever will help. But I hope you'll do something. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
I would like to speak up in support of the ordinance. In Swepsonville, between Swepsonville and Saxbaha, we have an outdoor venue that happens every other weekend. It lasts all weekend, starts at 11 o'clock, goes until whenever, 2, 3 o'clock, until the sheriff finally comes and shuts them down. And the sheriff has been wonderful. They just don't have anything that they can use. This music venue is on the river, and my house is a half a mile away. And it sounds like my teenagers are in their bedrooms with their stereos on. It is disturbing the peace, and that's all we're asking for is, you know, and we don't even have any problem with them having the venue. It's just keeping it low enough that it's not disturbing the neighborhood. We've talked to people up and down the river, and some people say they have heard it 5 miles down the river. Now, I'm sure it's because sound bounces along the river, and this venue happens to be on the river, but you know, anything you can do to help our sheriff's department, we would greatly appreciate.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Commissioners?
I got a question about the Oasis situation. What legal teeth do we have now? Maybe you can explain that from the attorney side as to what do we have with what this ordinance is saying.
It's addressed on page 3 in paragraph 15. Mm-hmm. The distinction between commercial speech and non-commercial speech. Commercial speech, such as a bar, can be unreasonable under this ordinance as rewritten. It's easier to define it using something that is deemed to be an unreasonable and disturbing noise than it is for me to go to court and try and prove what an unreasonable and disturbing noise is or is not.
So we really still don't have anything here that would...
Well, you distinguish them between non-commercial speech, such as somebody standing out on the street corner with an amplifier,
right,
and saying, vote for me, which is covered in subparagraph A there, and non-commercial speech, which can be prohibitive if it's unreasonable. And I think the test is unreasonable and unnecessary. If you can hear something 5 miles away, that's probably unreasonable. If you can hear something 200 yards away when I'm trying to sleep, I'd say that's unreasonable.
That's
That's just my opinion, but you see, that's the point.
Well, from what he's saying, that they have been there.
Decision and tell a judge, I was out there, Your Honor, that night, and I heard it, and I was 250 yards away. And the judge says, thank you very much. And that's why you have it in the ordinance this way.
Okay.
Rather than having to worry about a decibel meter, when you've got water involved,
it's more
hills
subjected
involved,
with
trees.
The deputy being right there, to him standing in your doorway hearing the loud noise.
And I have yet to have one say that it wasn't a disturbing noise.
So now we have something. At least if they go one time, second time, they can actually find them. And if they go at the right time and they're yelling obscenities, they can do other things,
well,
right?
One other question, though, too, is that like one of the deputies mentioned under current ordinance that he could not leave a citation because the owner of the building was not there. Well, the owner of the business, is, and there never seems to be an owner there, and nobody runs the place. Is that
I can't speak
part of this ordinance?
Maybe Al needs to check.
No, I can't speak to that. It would, my understanding of it would be that the property owner would be responsible for the noise on their property.
Even though he's leasing
the property? Well, if he's leasing the property, the person in care, control, and custody of the property would be the one that would get the citation, in my opinion. Would that be correct, Mr. Albright?
It would, and then when we go to enforce, it's the property owner.
Probably whoever has their name on the license to sell alcohol.
Like if you allow a nuisance on your property for junk vehicles or trash, and you say, well, my tenant did that, and we say, well, you own the property, then you have to pay the fine.
So in your opinion, this would take care of that?
Even though it's still a business, the bar is still a business?
Yes. It's unreasonable and unnecessary.
Is it same for industrial
too,
also?
Now, that don't say.
Remember, the test is unreasonable and unnecessary. If you're living next to a sawmill and you hear a saw, that's part
necessary.
Of the
test. That's necessary.
Even at 2 in the morning?
Shouldn't
there
be time?
Textile mills, same way. You know, I mean,
that's inside. You're talking about a galvanized plant. They're outside, outdoors.
Well, the
we
test,
don't really deal with an outdoor
the industrial test, facility. The test, is it unreasonably loud? Is it disturbing? And is it unnecessary?
And in this case, it's easily controlled just by simply turning the volume down. It's not like trying to control the noise from a sawmill.
Well, like I say, we have been to South Atlantic, unless, and I did sit at the highway, which is where your house is. And I did not hear anything whatsoever but road noise, which came up and down the road. So,
what time did you come by
there? We were there while they were in operation.
It was in the morning.
We were.
Like the day.
But I can go down there at 12 o'clock at night.
We can bring you video and audio of what we're listening to day and night.
Well, I can come down there. Yes, sir.
The forklift runs all.
It does. It does.
It does. You can hear it plain today. It runs all the time.
Well, and like I said, we did not hear anything, and it is a business, and they have been there for 13 years, I guess. And
same as they
And this just came out recently, so I'm wondering why it didn't come out prior to that.
But is that loud music necessary to run that business at 2 o'clock?
Can he close back doors and shut?
Well, it is a dance hall.
Well, they can close. They can turn the noise level down. It's
exactly. And that right to have music ends where your nose begins. That's the law.
I hope.
So, any more comments, Mr. Sutton?
In regards to the citations, is there a potential court scenario that if they don't pay the ticket, they can go to court? How's that work? Do they have their day in court, so to speak?
If they don't pay the citation, they can appeal, be brought to court.
Okay.
Enforce it.
All right, that answers my question.
Okay, one more.
I'd just like to say that if the owners of the Oasis were here, they might very well say that loud music is essential to our business. This is what our customers expect, and this is a part of our business. And I don't see the difference between, I mean, really, it's a loud noise. South Atlantic steel galvanizing drops these humongous tons of steel into these vats. I've heard it, you know, it late at night. It wasn't maybe 2 in the morning. I wasn't over at Beverly Kerr's house. But we're still talking about the very same thing. It is a business, it's making a loud noise, and it is upsetting the public. And the gentleman that spoke about his family and his children, the Kerrs can no longer go in their backyard and even enjoy their own backyard because of this loud plant. So I just wanted to...
But I guess what I'm asking, though, is it's been there 13 years, and have you not heard this for 13 years?
We've been protesting him for years. Yeah. Every chance I get, I come up and talk to you and show you pictures and.
Well, we hadn't even been on a year.
Well, yet, maybe so. That's what it was. Like you wasn't here.
She's been here.
Thank you.
But.
And I want to add that Beverly's gotten more active now too. That's right. I'm speaking in.
Right.
You got one more question.
I got one more question. Yes.
yes, ma'am. The bar that he's talking about, I have lived behind for over 13 years, and I live over 1,000 feet from it. I have called the sheriff's department until I have wore the phone out. And what now? The leaves are on the trees, and it blocks it from me. But as soon as the leaves come off, it vibrates the windows in my house. You cannot sleep. I go to bed at 10 o'clock at night. I shouldn't have to stay awake until the drunks leave at 2 o'clock in the morning. And you call the sheriff's department, they don't hear it in the front. It's behind it with the bass that we're talking about. Right. If we could hear the music, we might enjoy it. But all we hear is the boom, boom, boom. I want you, Card, and I'll call you to come to my house and hear it. I have asked the sheriff.
And that man can be controlled. He can Ma'am control
has
his.
It in all of these years.
That's why we're doing this.
That's
why we're doing with this ordinance, okay. It will be controlled.
That's what I'm saying. His can be controlled.
Yeah, well,
his business.
That's right.
Because he can turn the music down.
Every time we get a new owner, it's a different story.
It cannot be controlled at that point because that is what they do. And that is their living, and they've been there for 13 years. That's what I'm saying. So,
the same owner hasn't been there for 13
years. No, I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about the other. Yeah. And I have a band that practices right below my house, and I hear it, but I don't pay attention to it. So, but anyway, any more questions?
South Atlantic could stop their operation after midnight for the peace of the neighborhood.
Well, have you been?
We might send a letter to them and ask them if they could cut down on the noise. That would be an idea. If we're not going to do anything to restrict them from doing business, I don't think we should. But we should send a letter. We should send a letter and ask them if we can, if they would cut down on the noise after midnight.
That was part of why we went down there, because if they're making a loud noise dropping in bats, then something is going wrong with that piece of metal because they don't want it to drop.
They can ease that. They got a crane if they can lower that and they don't have to let it boom.
Once in a while they do drop some of the, when they're picking it up, and we did hear that. But even standing in there, I didn't have earplugs in it. And honestly, even standing right there at it did not affect me at all. So,
it sounds like maybe when the owner's not there, the plant manager's not there, then the guys just kind of start getting slack.
Well, no, he's always there. The owner's son runs it. So,
this is second shift too. They're second shift employees making that noise.
Yeah. Well, we'll go back down there on second shift.
We have heard the complaints of that, and that's why we went out to look at it.
Yeah, we did. We went out.
Now, if a speedway was racing every night of the week till 12 o'clock. You would have people up here with pitchforks, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's the business operating. They could legally, if they wanted to, race.
They can.
Why not?
Because they got the acreage to run their business like they want to.
And the residents around there.
And another thing is we don't have zoning. And zoning makes a difference in Alamance County. And I'm not for zoning, I'll tell you right now. But it does make a difference because that's when you can control it. Am I not right, Mr. Martin? To some degree. And I'll let you address that.
I will say zoning, I guess one of the planning board members last year said it best. It's, you know, putting like things together pretty much. And how it would, without zoning, you don't have ways to set aside certain areas where you want to see these businesses go. It's a form of planning to do that. Now, the argument against zoning is that it adds extra hurdles for business to go through. And right now, given the economic climate of not just Alamance County, but this country, do we want to put any more hurdles in place for businesses to jump through? No. With unemployment at 13% and things like that.
That's exactly right.
There's a time and a place for that. And my stance on zoning has always been, when it's not going to be Jason Martin stand up here saying we need zoning, it's going to be the Board of Commissioners directly to go back and look at zoning. Or the planning board comes with me and says, make a recommendation on that very issue. But yeah, to answer your question, yeah, there are certain things that would make easier for enforcement. Obviously, at that point, you could look at decibel meters and things like that, and it would make a lot of sense. But we don't have that to look at right now. So,
Madam Chair, if we could, ma'am. I'd like to.
Why don't you have?
I'm sorry. It all. Are you going to close the?
Yeah, I'm going to close the public comment. Yeah, at this point, and then because I think we've had. We've heard one man. I will let you say something if you want to right there. Mr. Everybody Ross. Else has done spoke one time. Are you okay?
I would just like to say that if you'll come down there about 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning, and I live about probably 3.5 miles from the place, and I used to let sleep with my windows up, and I can't do that anymore because of the noise. And I will say this about the Oasis. This is the second time they have tried to do something about that. And so that's all I care to say. Thank you.
Okay, I'll entertain your.
Well, I think we need to go ahead and vote on this tonight and put this in place. I'd like to make a motion that we accept what the planning board has brought back to us and put it up for a motion.
I'll second that. It's the lesser of the evils. I second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Okay, we will go with this at this point. Okay? But you call me. I'll be glad to come down. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the proclamation for the National 4-H Week and Beth Davis. Hey, Beth. I would, Mr. Shue, I have your email, and I will answer your question in an email, okay? Is that, which one do you use? Do you have one besides?
Ed don't lie.
The crazy Eddie is also.
I don't hear what.
Okay. Well, I mean, I'm just reading that. Okay. I'm just checking to see how I can get in touch with you, okay?
Hard to follow that, right?
Good evening.
Hello.
My name is Beth Davis, and I work with the Cooperative Extension Service as the 4-H agent. And this week is National 4-H Week, and this week is especially exciting because this is the centennial for North Carolina 4-H. So it's 100 years, and I brought a pin for each of the commissioners and also for the county manager. So I will give those to you guys at the end of my little presentation. And I brought a proclamation, which I did last year for the first time. And also, after I read that, I'm going to talk about our event at the end of the week. So I'll read the proclamation, and Madam Chairman, if you can sign it at the end. So, whereas the youth of any community are its greatest natural resource, and whereas 4-H is the largest youth organization in North Carolina, with nearly 1 in every 8 North Carolina youth involved in 4-H, and whereas 4-H in North Carolina claims more than 200,000 youth members and 27,000 adult volunteers, while Alamance County's 4-H program numbers 932 youth and 89 volunteers, And whereas 4-H addresses issues facing youth wherever they live, in inner cities, suburbs, and rural communities, and helps break barriers by focusing on learning by doing. And whereas 4-H has programs on food and nutrition, science and technology, natural resources, substance abuse prevention, growing plants, caring for farm animals, career education, community pride, citizenship and leadership. And whereas exciting, fun, and student-centered educational programs are available through county 4-H school enrichment programs. And whereas 4-H, as part of the North Carolina Cooperative Extension Service, is a program where youth learn together in all kinds of projects, events, and activities. Now, therefore, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners do hereby proclaim October 4th through the 10th, 2009, National 4-H Week in Alamance County, and urge the people of this county to take advantage of the opportunity to become more aware of this special program, which gives youth the chance to learn together and to be a part of Alamance County 4-H and support the work of the 4-H Youth Development Program. And I believe you have a copy in front of you?
We do. Okay. And actually, we have it in our packet here, and okay. I've already signed that. So.
Okay. And
and you might want to tell them about the birthday party.
Okay. Yeah. All right. And I have that information right here in front of me.
Okay.
We are having a big birthday party, and everybody here and in the county is invited to attend. We are celebrating, like I said, 100 years of 4-H. And actually, next year, 2010, is the 100th birthday of Alamance County 4-H. And so we're having a birthday party this Saturday at Thataways Youth Center in Burlington from 1 to 4, and everybody's invited. We're going to start at 1 o'clock, as I said, and we do ask that everybody wear green because that's our color. And if you can bring canned food or some sort of non-perishable item, we're going to donate those items to community services agencies. Their food pantry is pretty bare right now, so we're going to give them those items. We have some kids that have turned in a cake decorating contest, and so they're going to be judged, and we're going to eat that cake and then also some other cake because that's not enough to feed everybody. And we're also getting some ice cream, so you can't have a birthday party without cake and ice cream. We're going to play some games, 4-H Bingo and 4-H Jeopardy, and we're going to also have a dance afterwards. So that's what we're going to do at our birthday party, so we hope everybody can come and join us. And we're also on Wednesday. Many of you may know about the Alamance Walks program through the county. We're going to be out helping out with that program on Wednesday. So that's our plans for this week. So
thank you, Beth.
Thank you.
4-H is very good.
And I'm also an alumni, so I know it's a great program.
Myself.
Thank you. And Linda's on our board.
So. I am.
Yes.
They told me they never had a county commissioner on the 4-H board. So
there you go. You
get and so first. Whenever people call me, I just get in the car
Thank
and go.
You.
And we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
100 years. It's a great program.
Okay. It is. Super. And they raise little bitties up, I tell y'all. Then they have to give them away, don't
they? They're supposed to hatch this week.
Oh, good. Okay. Okay. Call me. I want to see those little bees. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is Medicaid report card update with Ms. Susan Osborne. How are you tonight?
I'm good. Good evening. At the request of Commissioner Sutton, I wanted to update you on our progress with the Medicaid report card. And if you remember, that's timely processing of Medicaid applications within 45 days, and that's the federal requirement. If you remember, back in February of 2009, we had a local compliance team because of our failure of the report card. We presented to you in March of 2009 with some options and some assistance that we needed. In April, we entered into a corrective action plan with the state of North Carolina. And the good news tonight, we had 90 days to complete that with an allowable 190-day extension, so we had 180 days. And the good news is that with your help and the resources that you appropriated us when we were here in March, we have passed the report card in June, July, and August. So we feel like we're on the right track. We filled both the new positions that you gave us. We have implemented the automation solution, and that's going fairly well. That is a imaging system and a forms package that allows us, really, for the benefit of the workers' efficiency and for the customer service that we provide, that when one of our clients brings in a wage form, instead of having to take that to three different workers and copy that for three different records, it's scanned in. We have no paper going forward. It's pretty amazing if you came to see DSS 6 months ago and see it now. We've really cut out a lot of paper. We're going to save in excess of $20,000 on paper and toner just this year.
Wow.
It's awesome. So we scan that in, and it's available to all the workers who are processing those different types of applications. So you have in front of you a summary of the report card for the last 3 years. You can kind of see where we had, where we were doing well, and then where we had some turnover. We had frozen positions. We didn't do so well, and I think now we're on the right track. So I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have. You have updated figures in your memo to kind of know where we are. The caseload is growing. As you all know, in a downturn of our economy, your local Department of Social Services is where a lot of your citizens are coming for help, for food stamps. You can read in USA Today and CNN that food stamps are growing across the nation, as well as they are here in Alamance County, as well as our Medicaid applications. So I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have, but I wanted to thank you for your support. Thank you for the opportunities that you gave us to improve, and we will continue to keep you informed about our progress, but we feel like we're really on the right track. Thank you.
You would get
right
some.
If it's okay. Back when this first broke, as far as my being concerned, it was when there was a letter, of course, put in with some of our mail about the report card process,
yes,
which I didn't even realize that went on.
Yes, sir.
And of course, we saw that within that 12-month period that we looked at, there was, I think we had flunked at 8 out of 12. Mm-hmm. And then this second year now, since we looked at it back then, I believe we've again failed 8 out of 12, if I'm not mistaken. My first question is, what was it the third year? I mean, the first year. In other words, you said 3 years back, you said it's on one.
Uh-huh. In 2007.
How many?
We passed 6 out of 12. We failed 6 out of 12.
Okay.
In 2007.
So 6, 8, and 8. That we've failed in the last 3 years out of 12.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. We're at three of five. We've passed 3 of 5 this year. No, I'm sorry. We've passed 3 and failed 5 this year.
Right. Okay. What's the status of NC Fast?
NC Fast, let's see, has been around for about 15 years. NC Fast is an effort to consolidate a statewide system to implement all of our income, to process income maintenance cases. So whereas right now we're still using a manual process to determine eligibility for food stamps or Medicaid, NC Fast would load the rules into a computer program. And so all you'd have to do is input and have an answer about eligibility. Right now, our staff have manuals about like that with all these exceptions and all these different programs. NC Fast, like I said, they've been working towards that for about 12 years. The latest I heard was that they may have a prototype sometime in 2011 with full implementation by 2017.
Okay. If that comes to fruition, what does that do to systems like Northwood?
It'll be integrated with it.
Okay.
Because of North, the big piece of Northwood's is an imaging system and not a case management system. And NC Fast is case management.
Okay.
So it'll be integrated and it'll complement. We'll be ahead of the curve.
All right. I guess we can all fault one another when we look at comparisons and say it's not apples to apples, or, you know, we're not doing what maybe another county's doing or whatever, and maybe we should just take care of our own. But I still believe we have to look at what some other people are doing and what their track record is, especially when their track record showing that they're, in this particular case, passing all of their report cards.
Yes, sir.
And I think we can all claim it, you know, they have different tools. Like Randolph has, I understand what, I was on the phone for a couple hours today with this stuff again.
Randolph built their own system.
Yeah, it's called Sarah, what is it?
Serenade.
Yeah, Serenade.
Yes, sir.
And then they push everything over into Laserfish.
Which we have here in Alamance.
Okay.
Using as a part of our solution.
But I have to point out the comparison with Davidson County. Not to say that they're the best county in the state as far as fiscal conservatism or efficiency, but I have to still look at the numbers. Where they passed all their reports for the last 2 years.
Yes, sir.
24 out of 24. Don't know what they did the first year of the three-year cycle that we've heard about tonight. But it's my understanding that did we use one case?
We do.
Okay. So you've had, how long have you had one case?
We implemented one case in 1994. We were one of the first counties to use one case.
Here's my point that I'm trying to make with one case. It's my understanding that, and I could be wrong, but that Davidson has, and Randolph both have, more cases in three of the categories that, according to the report that we got. I showed it's ranking third in food stamps, third in Medicaid recipients, and third in households receiving food stamps back when we looked at this about a year ago, of the three, Randolph and Davidson. But Davidson, while passing 24 out of 24 of their periods, in the same fields that we have to deal with, and in my belief that they even have more cases, they have an employee differential of where we're claiming, I think, today 196, is that correct? Total 196 people in social services?
I think that might be a tad high, but it's close to that.
I believe that's what I was told today.
That's what we got from
Okay.
Today, Davidson County said they had 169. So, you know, that's quite a differential, in my opinion, especially when you're handling as many, if not more, cases in the categories that are being reviewed, and they're passing all the reports, and they're using what we cast off, the one case system.
Well, we're still using one.
Okay, but my point is they're not using anything but one case. Mm-hmm. They didn't go to the more what you might call expanded case management system. And as a matter of fact, they told me today that they were up here looking at our one case system where y'all had purchased some templates for our, whatever that means.
That's right. We use that in our services, in our child welfare and our adult services. One case is fully implemented, and that's all they use.
Right.
Northwoods was bought just for the income maintenance piece.
Right. Well, my question is, though, and I can't help but ask this, and I mean this as sincerely as I can say it. I'm not trying to destroy anybody. I'm not trying to hurt anybody's credibility, but I have to ask this question. How can they pass 24 out of 24 with much less employees using the same system that we said wasn't adequate, and we cast it off in favor of a $400,000 new system? You know, they told me today they were up here back in November or the fall of last year looking at our system, being trained on how to further enhance theirs, yet we were getting ready to throw ours out.
We didn't throw it out.
Well, I mean, you spent a whole lot more to add to it, though.
Well,
with Northwood.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Northwood serves our income maintenance workers. That's our Medicaid and our food stamp workers.
Right.
One case, other than double entry into income maintenance, one case serves just services, and Northwood serves just our income maintenance side. So we're still using both. One case tremendously, and as they mentioned, they were here.
But we were on equal planes at one time as far as what was available.
Well, and I would like to share with you, this is just a copy of Ms. Sherry Hook's survey, and all I did was add at the bottom, I took out the frozen positions that we had at DSS. The fraud positions and the outpost positions were subtracted out. So, and we looked at applications that we're receiving on a yearly basis as well. So, you know, while we do have, it sounds like 20 more employees than Davidson County, we also have many grant employees. We have many supplemental employees. Not all counties have child support. So there are a lot of ways to compare that. But when I look at the available staff that we had at the time that we were not passing the report card, we had 53 staff in income maintenance to handle 4,253 applications. As you can see, Randolph had 60 staff, seven more than we did to handle about the same number. And Davidson had 65, about 12 more staff than we did to handle a little less than 1,000 applications. It's difficult to look at entire staff this is our income maintenance staff, and these were the folks that were available to work on that report card issue. And so,
how you distribute your staff. Now, they would say, I think, to me, well, we've got, you know, the same issues down here. We just choose to distribute our people a little differently. For instance, Randolph County told me today they have 160 employees to our 196. Yet, if you look at this sheet right here, they've got 1,700, our 1,240 food stamp applications. Year to date, whatever period you're looking at here, they had 6,500 numbers of households receiving food stamps to our 6,000.
Yes, sir. And Randolph County doesn't have child support.
I understand that. And we talked to them.
Workers.
Well, they told me today. No, I talked to them about that today.
Yeah, I mean, that's for us, that's 25 workers.
Okay, but they're considering moving theirs from out. They're doing Vanguard, I understand. Is that correct?
No, they're under state operating.
Okay, but whatever they're using, they're going to try to consider pulling it in-house, and told me it might not be but 10 to 12 more people for their staff. So at that point, still 172 to our 196. I just have to, you know, I know it's not a perfect apples to apples. Nothing in this world is. But
no,
I have to just say, what is your professional analysis of why Davidson especially can pass every report card for 2 years while we flunked 16 out of 24 with the same equipment, really probably less equipment, but definitely at least the same with less employees, 20 to 30 less employees. How do we justify that? How do you?
Well, our staff is distributed based on the needs and based on state standards. So when we look at, you know, when you gave us two additional workers last year in child welfare, it was because we actually needed four. So our staff is divided based on state standards and state recommendations for standard caseload. We had, at this time, when we were not passing the report card, only 53 workers associated with, compared to Davidson's 65 workers.
But again, it's distribution of those workers.
Well,
we can play on that all we want.
It is.
Yeah.
That's correct. And
you could elect to move them over to
category
where they didn't.
Well,
you know, you have moved them.
Well,
somewhere
we've justified the need for those positions along the way because of our caseloads and child welfare. Many of those positions are grant funded. We have several grant funded in assessors that we've added through our grants that the county hadn't had to add. So we have many grant-funded positions as well.
Well, I know I'm not going to be able to reinvent the wheel here, and I'm not really trying to. I'm just saying that, to me, I see in Randolph's analysis and Davis's analysis a level of efficiency that I just can't see statistically here, especially given the systems that they have available to them. Now, Randolph told me, he said, you know, one of the persons down there laughed. They said, well, you possibly could make the case of, if they have a full-blown case management system that has all the bells and whistles that Northwood has versus the one they're using, especially the one that Davidson's using, with the numbers of employees, the ratio's there that you probably could say, well, seeing how I've got the Cadillac of contract of case management tools, that we could do without 20 employees possibly. Well, you can make that argument.
Well, and I think when we do have a case management system like NCFAS that mm-hmm. actually calculates, that we may very well come to that, but we don't have that now. I mean, even Northwoods doesn't calculate the benefit level. That's all done manually. Okay.
Well, it's obvious I'm not going to be able to convince you, and I'm sticking with the stats I'm looking at.
Okay.
Respectfully, we'll just have to disagree on okay. whether the efficiency level's there or not. One last question.
Yes, sir.
I understand that one case is being used, that the gentleman that runs this is Tom Cox in Charlotte.
Yes, sir.
Okay, how many systems in the state use one case?
There was about 17, the last count I had.
Well, is he a private entrepreneur on this,
or
did he devise the system?
He did, and we bought it in 1994. We were one of the first counties to purchase.
What do we pay for?
I do not know.
Well, what do we use it for now if we have Northwood?
We use it for the services side. So all of our adult protective services, all of our child welfare, all of those notes, all that case management piece for all of our services are in one case. Also, that's our master client index. We use it to run our front reception desk. We use it to pay our daycare payroll. We have it well integrated.
What do the templates cost?
Between $10,000 and $15,000, probably.
And we added those on, right? When did we add those on?
The stored file template for the structured tool that the state identified in child welfare probably 2 years ago.
Okay. All right. I appreciate all of the information.
Sure.
Thank you.
Always.
Anybody else got any more questions for Susan?
Thank you.
Thank you. I think you're doing a great job. Because I've worked in DSS and I know what it is. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the out-of-state travel request for blanket authority. Mr. Britt?
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm here on behalf of Sheriff Johnson tonight to make a request. We've had the opportunity and have been using a regional counter-drug training academy in Meridian, Mississippi. It's actually on the Naval Air Station, an active duty base down there. We've been sending some officers. They specialize in counter drug for the southeastern United States, so it's offered specifically there. Once our deputies attend, the lodging's provided there, registration's providing. It's just a matter of getting them there and back. Under the new policy, we have to submit in writing for approval. One of the things that happens with this is they call us and say, we've got two slots, three slots, and it may be within a week or two or less notice sometimes. And it's very good training, specific to our narcotics, human trafficking type cases, and would like to have a request to be able to send officers as they come open to that school. It runs about $60 a deputy.
That's cheap. They're going to supply all the cost, and that's only going to cost. That's cheap.
They supply everything once we're there, and it's not. I know sometimes folks think that we send folks to the beautiful luxury places in the country, but this is actually on a military base.
So they stay in barracks.
And they stay on the base there.
Yeah. No frills.
No frills.
Anybody got any questions for Mr.
I don't have a problem with
it. I'll entertain a motion.
I'm sorry. Please. He expects me to. You don't want to cut that out.
Absolutely.
my problem is this blanket authority. Can we cap this? In other words, you're sending two this time, I think it was.
Two. Actually, a lieutenant and an investigator from our Vice Narcotics Unit. And we're asking specifically for this school, not a blanket authority for any other protocols. I think.
Okay, that's what I wanted to get clear too.
Specifically, we're asking specifically to this, the Regional Counter Drug Training Academy in Meridian, Mississippi. We would still send the appropriate paperwork to the manager. And he's aware of, we've actually had a couple opportunities where they would say, hey, we've got two slots, can you send somebody? And we've had to, it would fall between board meetings.
Yeah, and I know in the past he's emailed us, and I know I got right back to him.
Yeah, specifically to this academy, specifically to the Vice Narcotics and Human Trafficking Training.
Okay.
We will still update the board on anytime somebody goes out of state, but it's just with these classes become available very quickly. They have to have an acknowledgement basically the next day, so it leaves us a little time to bring it in front of the Board of Commissioners. So, but we would still keep you informed of who, what, and when. It, you know, it may be post-haste, but we will still let you know.
How many times a year do you anticipate?
We have sent
a chance to send people.
Don't have the exact numbers, but we've sent probably a dozen.
Would that be correct, Mr. Jones?
This year, and usually in twos.
And this is Homeland Security.
It's actually through the federal. It's through federal law enforcement, and it's there on the Naval Air Station. And it's actually called Regional Counter Drug Training, Southeast Region. They choose to do the training there at the Naval Air Station in Meridian, Mississippi.
Okay, and this would come out of whose budget? I know I saw it somewhere in some of these papers.
The $60 comes out of our travel and training.
Okay.
It's already a line item.
That budget, not the county budget.
Right.
That's what was left out, too.
Okay. I'll make a motion that we let them do this.
Okay. I'll second that.
Got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Okay. Now, are you going to do the next one, please? This is the budget amendment number 35 from the Sheriff's Office, and this is on JAG grants.
Yes, ma'am, and I'll give a little brief. Randy Jones has some more particular information. But
okay.
We've had the opportunity to receive two JAG grants from the Bureau of Justice in Washington. These are no-match grants, no cost to Alamance County as far as matching dollars. And the total of the two grants is $83,664. Randy Jones writes our grants and handles that, and I'll let him speak to any particular questions you may have.
As Chief Deputy Britt said, this is non-matching monies. That is, the county has put nothing up. The only requirement they normally have for these grants is it is a reimbursement grant, which means we have to pay the bill up front. They, in turn, reimburse us. My understanding is that as it stands right now, we're in a situation where there's three agencies together for totals of monies. This is the monies that are coming to us. Burlington serves as the actual guiding counselor for that. The money is already on deposit, waiting for us to spend it, basically what it
means. Get authorization.
These are funds that come most every year. There's no guarantee what the amounts are going to be. Their funds cannot be used to supplant budgets. It has to be for extra things that are not budgeted items. As I said, no planning to be done. And they vary greatly. You may go $10,000 this year and $100,000 next year. You have no idea from year to year what the amounts are going to be. As these become available, we make the applications. And then we have to have approved the items that are going to be purchased with these funds. And they have to approve those. And we keep them within law enforcement realm, obviously, and they're very understanding. This is going to deal with some vehicles and vehicle equipment and different things like this, bulletproof vests, things of that nature, that the county will not have to fund. All we're asking for in this is to have the money appropriate so we can spend it so they can then reimbursement, do the reimbursement.
I ask you a question on those bulletproof vests. My understanding is there's several different levels of it, of those vests. Are we getting vests for our people that would ward off high-powered rifles or whatever the latest
thing
is?
The only vest made that will ward off the high-powered rifles, you can only wear those about 15 minutes at a time. They're the true tactical entry vest. In reality, the real world, not the television world, the vest was known as soft body armor that's worn by our officers in the field will not stop a high-powered rifle. That's TV stuff, unfortunately. Yeah. We do have a couple of the entry tactical vests that will stop high-powered rifles, and you can stand them about 15 minutes physically because of the weight. These are state-of-the-art vests that will stop the rounds that we normally encounter in the field, 357 Magnum, 45s, things of that nature. They stop those.
Okay. That says a whole lot if you know anything about
But with law enforcement work. Quite honestly,
that big a caliber is unbelievable.
Who are they made by?
We go with a series of vests that there may be Second Chance. I believe these are Second Chance we're looking at. There's a set of approved vests under the federal programs that you have to comply with anyway.
Yeah.
And that's what we've done. A lot of the Safari Land, Second Chance, the top name vests that we go with. They're all the same threat level. So we use a standard threat level. So I do not have a better vest than you for both in the field. We know what the capabilities and limitations are of the vest.
Okay.
And we do use the state-of-the-art equipment with the covers and things of that nature. Fairly expensive on the individual basis, but then again, they save officers' lives. So. Yeah.
You can't put a price on that.
That's right. Right.
And I'll put a price on that. Okay. Any more questions?
One other statement. We would request we accept those monies and then also to transfer those monies to the two line items in the letter. Okay. One for the capital outlay for vehicles, the $49,307.
Okay.
And $34,357 in the small tools and equipment, and that's for the vest and the video equipment for the interview rooms.
Okay.
And the universal gun mounts that lock the guns, long guns in the patrol car.
Okay. I'll allow that. Okay.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
Got a second? All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed? Gotcha. Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the county manager's reports and the joint memorandum with the Alamance Burlington School System.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. In your agenda packets is a joint resolution. It's a memorandum of agreement between Alamance County and the Alamance Burlington School System. This is for the approval to apply for the bonds for the career and technical high school. And the total of this is $7,561,582. $4.991 million will come from the qualified school construction grants or bonds. That is part of the stimulus package. And the remaining funds that will come from the county or the school system's existing lottery funds, which is about $2.569 million. Debt service on this, on the $4.991 million, we would be responsible for $130,000 of that debt service, which would be $499,000, $316,000 or $416,000 annually for 12 years. We'd be responsible for $130,000, and recommendation from that is to use the savings from our bond refinancing that we just completed, and the remaining local lottery proceeds of $286,000 would come from the school system as part of their lottery funds. The school system has not approved of this yet, so we are the first ones that would have approval on this.
I know I asked a question about where they were going to build this, and I know Ms. Cole's here, and she probably can't answer that. And I know that Dr. Bridges said he couldn't tell me, but...
I don't even know.
Price of land would go way up.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'd have to take
I still have a question. I would still like to know where they are planning on building this technical.
And haven't heard myself. There was a question that Commissioner Sutton rose about the possibility of using existing land and using existing school sites. Mm-hmm. Dr. Bridges, I talked to him today, and he said that they did evaluate all five high school sites, either through traffic, property size, or environmental issues. Since this has to be done and the bond sold by December 31st, the environmental side, there was not enough time to jump through the hoops on, especially like Cummings with two retainage ponds, and the other ones just didn't work into their plans, but they did look at the request of Commissioner Sutton.
Well, they could have saved $1 million of the outlay had it been more innovative with that, but again, I made it clear then I wouldn't vote against the situation because of that, but I did recommend that.
So, any more questions? Okay.
Just another mention. Once it is approved, we will begin go ahead and the process of trying to sell these bonds. We are under a very tight deadline to December 31st, so a lot of work will have to be done between now and December 31st.
So we, if we approve this tonight, then the school board has to go and approve it at your next meeting. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Any more questions? Do I hear a motion?
Move.
I have a motion to second. Accept this. I've got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Okay. All right. The next thing, okay, what the protocol for economic development incentives?
Thank you again, Madam Chairman. Mm-hmm. In working with Mac Williams of the Alamance County Chamber of Commerce, who also serves as our economic developer, we basically put down in writing what the process has been in the past for the county with respect to economic incentives and how the process is handled. The big change is under the program procedures number 4 is a full disclosure of who the company is, and it will be given once you set the public hearing. In the past, you have set a public hearing without knowing who the company was, and then at the public hearing, you would then realize who the company you were seeking and who was seeking incentives. This will be a 2-week period where you can ask questions, do your research beforehand before you get to that public hearing, and kind of get hit in the face of saying, well, it's X company and we're asking you to approve it now. That is the big change, but this will be part of the policy. We would then give this policy out to anybody seeking incentives so that they are fully aware of the process. And if they say, well, we don't want to follow this, then we say, too bad. Sorry. So.
It never was rational, even though, you know, you might vote for it, you might vote against it, but it never was rational to think that we should sit here and approve thousands of dollars up to even quarter of a million dollars without knowing who the company was until the night they were here. That's not the way to run this county, I'll assure you, whether the Chamber of Commerce agrees with that or not. But I'm glad we changed it.
Now, Mr. Williams is here. If anybody has any questions of him about this,
He's right there. Okay, he's hiding behind the lady. Okay, I see you now.
Do you have any comments on this, Matt?
No.
Okay, you're fine with it. Okay. All right. So, do I hear a motion that we accept this development?
Yes, I move.
And a second?
Second.
Okay, and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. All right. Okay. Next, agenda procedures.
At the request of Commissioner Vaughn at our last meeting, attached is a recommended policy for rules and procedures for citizens to place items on the agenda for the Board of Commissioners meeting. There's been a concern that's been arisen about the 8-minute time frame. And let me first say that is a recommendation. And if it needs to be changed, it is a will of council. Or excuse me, I'm you saying city council commissioners, that if in the policy now it states that after the 8 minutes, the board, if they additional time is needed, the majority of the board can grant that additional time. But if you want to do away with the time frame of and leaving that open ended, that is your choice as well, or any other changes that you would like to make. Again, this is only a recommendation, and if more work needs to be done, please let me know.
I'll open for questions. I don't like the 8 minutes. I don't think we need to. I think that's not enough time for a lot of people.
You could word it reasonable.
Reasonable.
Yeah, and I just don't like the 8 minutes. I think we need to just take it out, and I think most people will be reasonable if we ask them to.
Okay.
And I don't like that. Now, as far as the 3 minutes is concerned, or we can give them 2 more minutes if we want to on public comment. Was that not in here as well? Or did we, you and I talked about
it? Right. That is the discretion of the chair.
But I just don't like, to just say, okay, you only got 8 minutes and they may have a 10 minute or a 15 minute. And most people don't take much longer than that anyway. And lots of times I do ask them, and it's like I said about before, Hannah Gill, I did not tell her she could not talk. She only wanted 5 minutes. I have an email on that that says she only wanted 5 minutes, and I was going to give her the 5 minutes in public comment, and she didn't show up. So that was a question about the last meeting. But Mr. Ansbacher and I have spoken, and he and I are on the same page. And so anyway, I don't like the 8 minutes. I don't know what you guys think, but I don't like it.
I think it just put reasonable.
Yeah. We can reword it and put reasonable.
Yeah.
I would like to take out the word personal attacks on staff. Not that I'm in favor of personal attacks, but if the public has a complaint, this is the place they need to air it. And I think by taking that out, would, you know, it takes the freedom of the openness of this meeting away from the public, and the public pays the bills for the county. The least thing we can do for the public and the county is to allow them to come here and complain. You know, that's what this body is, to hear the complaints of the county. So I'd like to see us take that out. So the commissioners may take out, and I want to take it out. Personal attacks should be allowed.
Any comments on that?
That's opening up a new arena right there.
They all complain about the county commissioners. They should have a right to do that also.
Attack versus critique is right. Two different things.
Job performance.
Yeah, so, yeah, as long as they throw a tomato at me, I'm all right. So, yeah.
Me too. Right. If they throw a tomato at me, they're going to get an ass whooping.
It's live TV.
That's right.
Yes.
I don't know how to follow that one.
Frank, are you going to audit this?
I'm not sure you can.
Clarify personal attacks, okay? If they have a criticism.
Criticisms are fully allowed, but if it becomes that, well, this person is the SOB or, you know, that was what more of the personal attacks was and not somebody upset with job performance.
And that's what they're here to do is talk about job performance.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. So can we leave it in?
Yeah. You can reword it to.
Yeah. We reword it to criticism.
Criticism should be accepted. Yeah.
Professional criticism.
Professional criticism.
As long as it's professional.
Yeah.
Professional criticisms are allowed of staff and board of commissioners.
Right.
Yeah.
Anything else in here?
Yeah. I'm looking at the last, very last sentence. If someone comes and wants to be put on the agenda, and the final word is no, you can't be on that for whatever reason, do we have something set up for an appeal? Even a convicted felon has the right of appeal. And these people that show up at our meetings are not convicted felons, I don't think. Hope not. But anyway, is there a route for an appeal?
Probably the best appeal, if somebody was denied to be on the agenda, was that person to come down public input and speak and say, I was denied to speak at the agenda. I would like to ask the Board of Commissioners to allow me to speak at the next meeting.
That would work.
That would work, and that'd be happy.
Yeah.
That would work.
Yeah. Okay.
We can write that in there if you would like.
And that's fine.
Yeah.
Please. Anything else? Do I hear a motion to accept it with the amendments?
So moved.
And a motion to accept it with the amendments. And second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Good deal. Okay. Next is the workshop for the week of October 12th through the 16th.
Also, at our last meeting, there was discussion from the board about our upcoming Group B projects, and wanted to make sure that we went over the projects and you know exactly what we were going to go out for bid on, making sure that, again, the board was comfortable with the process and the projects that we were doing. We are suggesting the week of the 12th through the 16th, which is next week, to hold that workshop, and we can just schedule that with the architects. And you know, any questions or concerns that you have, before we go out to bid, you know, that probably would be the time to do it, or any clarification that you need. So if you have a time that is more suitable.
I prefer the mornings myself, because I've got to teach a class in Greensboro that week. So.
I have a little problem with morning, because I teach in the morning too. Yeah. But, I mean, I can probably make arrangements to get somebody to help me out with that.
I don't have a problem.
How long would we be meeting?
I guess less than 2 hours.
Okay.
Is that each day?
No, sir. Just
one day.
I'll give you a range. So
I looked at that
one day.
Yeah. As long as I can leave here by 2 o'clock. So, morning to 2 is fine with me.
Could we do a lunch meeting? I mean, would that work?
Yeah, could be done at lunch where Eddie could.
We can do it.
Because I can be here at 12 and
yeah, 10. Yeah, that'd work.
Give us time for 10.
Yeah.
That's fine with me, too.
That'd be fine with me. We can work around.
I do have some lunch meetings, though, but I can get out of it. Since I'm on about 10 committees, I can get out of that.
Remember, it's a brown bag lunch.
Okay, right. Yeah.
We understand that.
It's a brown bag.
That's fine. So, probably Thursdays are better for lunch for me.
No, not during that week.
Do the
15th?
15th's fine. You got a conflict with that?
I'm trying to remember. I have to refer to that calendar at home on the desk.
I know Mondays and Tuesdays and Wednesdays I have a lot of meetings.
15th.
Yeah. I'll make arrangements.
Let's go for 15th.
15th, is that?
15th, and we'll say from 12 to 2.
Okay.
And we'll provide the water.
12 to 2.
Yeah,
we'll meet
we'll
here.
Bring the water.
And we'll meet in the chambers.
Yes,
sir.
Okay.
We're going to meet here.
Right. Yes, sir.
Okay.
We don't need to vote on this. It was a consent. Okay. Next is the consent agenda. A is out-of-state travel request. We are going to pull B. There is a problem there, so everybody can pull that. Does anybody want to pull anything on this?
Yeah, I've got two. A2 and D.
A2 and D.
Yeah, I
wanted
to pull that one too.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's start with A2.
How about A1? And I did talk to Tim, where it says budget down the bottom. And I know I ask this question each time and I get the same answer. Whose budget?
That's the travel we just spoke of. That's the sheriff's office budget. Yeah. I think we can spend somebody else's budget.
Well, yeah, but that's also the county budget, so I wanted to be sure. Okay, just for the record.
Yeah.
They
do in Washington, so yeah.
So can we put that back on?
Oh, sure.
All right. Okay, Mr. Sutton, yours is the MIS?
Yeah, MIS. Frank, I'm glad you're here. This Cisco package?
Yes, sir.
Was that a, when did we put that in?
When did we put it in?
Yeah.
Right now, we're running on the Juniper and the check.
So you're wanting to go with Cisco, is that what you're saying? Okay.
It's actually a better package, and like I said, if you'd read the memo from Greg, that's our initial point of entry into the system. You get past the firewall, you're into our whole network, and that's 800 computers, 50 servers, social services, health department, board of elections, the whole works.
Now the trip, the travel request is for Cisco training, is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, well, when will we know whether we take a Cisco or not?
The recommendation is that we take the Cisco.
Is that part of the travel? Can't be part of the travel request.
I'm not sure I understand.
Okay, well, when have we approved Cisco is what I'm saying.
We've already done that based on the cost of the Juniper and the checkpoint. We're saving money on that.
Have we approved it, or has it been approved budget-wise, budgetary-wise?
It's in the budget.
It's in your budget.
It's in the yearly budget.
It's in that budget.
No increase up
no,
front?
No, sir. Lines? I said we're saving money.
Okay. Why in the world would, first of all, one's going to Atlanta and the other one's going to Norfolk. Is it the same training?
In that case, yes. It's just different locations. We're trying to get the training in fast enough so that we can get the software installed before we run out of the maintenance on the other products.
Yeah.
We don't want to have a lapse in support between the checkpoint and the Jupiter mm-hmm. to the time that we put the Cisco product in place.
Why would it not be part of the package, though, too? I mean, forget it.
We beat them down pretty good. We beat them down about 18,000 on the
product. We go with their product. Why is it not part of the deal that the training would be included? I mean, I think paying $7,500 for two people to be trained over a period of, a week apiece? That's just exorbitant to me.
I understand what you're saying.
Okay, but why is it not part of the package, though?
It's never been on any that I've ever dealt with, Mr. Sutton. I guess it's just the way the industry operates. Like I said, we beat them down on the price, about $18,000 on the product.
What was the total product price?
Close to 40.
40,000. $7,500 to be trained to run it.
Now, can you imagine how long it would take us and how much it would cost to clean up 800 computers if we got a virus in the network?
All right, who's using Cisco in the state of North Carolina?
About 80% of them.
Is it that widespread? Because
yeah,
Cisco's, I've heard about this.
Yeah, Cisco is probably the major player in the network industry. Nortel used to be up there, but Nortel is fading out, and they're being bought out and basically being disbanded almost, if you want to put it that way. So Cisco is your major player now.
Okay.
The state uses Cisco.
Okay. I'm happy. I think the training process sounds a little bit,
it's
not good business, you know.
It's
good business for them. I don't think it's good business for us. To me, that's an exorbitant cost.
But without training, it's
not good. I understand that.
They have to pay these instructors. These guys are, well, they're whirly birds. Their head's way up in the clouds somewhere, if you want to be accurate about it. You'd have a hard time talking to them, you know, just common sense street language.
How long have we used Jupiter?
We've been on Jupiter for...
Jim, for about 3 years or 4 years. The checkpoint firewall has been in place since we put a firewall in place, so going on 10 years, 9 years.
What's their track record in North Carolina?
I'm not sure. I'd have to research that, but they're a significant player in the firewall market, but not in the broader networking market. ASA's kind of taken over their market space, but it's really the cost that's driving a significant decision to go there.
So all this is
and the feature set.
Right.
Again, it's going to be a cost savings.
I realize that, but was it in the budget?
Yes,
sir. Yeah, okay. It's in the budget. Did a good job.
Okay.
You got one?
No.
Okay, and then
I got D.
Yeah.
I got A.
All right, the personnel.
Yes, sir.
The problem I have with this is, is in the middle of the year, we're going back and adding employees, and that, you know, it should wait till the fiscal year starts.
Well, we've asked for this position for 5 years in a row and haven't been funded. I'm not asking for a new position. We're just asking to move money from within our budget to contract with somebody to get us to the next budget year with no benefits and just a contract.
It's still in the same budget you had.
Right, within our budget.
So it's no increase.
Just to move it from our contract service line to salaries and wages. So that we can respond. When we had 1.5 APS workers on our staff, we were getting about 91 reports a year. Now we're averaging about 263, which is about a 300% increase. We've asked for this position for 5 years in a row. We've moved folks around. This staff monitors family care homes. One part of our adult services and the other part has adult protective services. So we've moved folks the best we can, but we have a responsibility to monitor family care homes, and that work is critical as well. And we've gotten to a point where we can't move folks. So we would like to have just a half-time, 24 hours a week, through the end of the year. And we'll be asking probably for this position again in the budget. This will be our sixth year in a row without it being funded.
So if we're at 196, if we buy that figure today, are we saying we're going to be at 197?
No, sir. We're just asking to move those funds and
she's still going to be 196.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Just want to make sure.
Well, we are talking about bringing somebody on contract, but it won't be a full-time position. We're not asking to add a position.
If you didn't do that with this person, what would you do? I mean, could you not move? Would you not move? Have you got to have this approval to move anybody around in the department?
No, we're asking to move funds around.
Uh-huh.
The funds.
It's already in your budget.
Yes, ma'am. Right.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. From one line, contracted services.
I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah, it's no.
That's what it's no.
Okay. I don't have a problem.
Well, let it be known, I think it does make a little sense versus what I was assuming. But back in 2003, 2004, according to this sheet here, Social Services had 164 employees. This was done by county staff, I guess. I didn't dream it up. And 164. And today we're at 196. I mean, people have been put over there. Might not be to everybody's satisfaction, but the track record's there.
Well, and when I look at our records for what we've added, in 2001, we lost 13 positions in 2000. And since in 2001, 2002, and since then, we've only added 13 back. So we're flat since 2001. We lost 13 positions.
How'd you lose those? What happened? You weren't.
Yes, I was.
Were you director then?
Yes, sir, I was.
Okay.
Those were RIF. That was the year that the county had to RIF positions, and they were RIF, those 13 positions.
All right, just define that.
Reduction force.
Oh, okay. It wasn't like we stripped you. I mean,
The positions were eliminated.
Yeah.
Most of them had been frozen as a part of the hiring freeze earlier in that year, and then one position had a person in it.
So according to this, and I'll vote for this, but 2003, 2004, 164, 172, 2004, 2005, 173, 2005, 2006, 6, 7, 82, 182, 2007, 08, 186, and then tonight we're hearing 196 for 08, 09. I mean, so.
We have, I'd be glad to get a total of grant positions we have.
Yeah.
I mean, many of those are 100% grant funded.
Yeah, I understand that.
And those grants have been approved.
But everybody gets grants. I mean, all the other social service departments get grants around the state, and they got 20 to 30 less employees. Does that logic not flow at all?
Well, a lot of DSSs don't have grants. That's not a normal thing.
SAMHSA is one of them that very few people.
That's right. Mecklenburg has a SAMHSA grant, but it's with their mental health. It's not with their social services department.
Susan, if I might add, also a difference that's made is there are a lot of counties that do not have the number of adult care homes that we have. We have probably 3 more adult home specialists than Randolph has. We have 63, 64 adult care homes to about, I think, around 9, something like that for Randolph. That's one difference. We also operate a CAPDA program, which this board has told us time and time again they were in favor of us keeping that program. A lot of county DSSs do not have CAPDA staff that's in a division of aging center or something within the county. We also have our legal staff, Jamie Hamill, our attorney, and her assistant in our office on our staff. A lot of counties, that's within the county staff. So it's not just the grant-funded positions, but there are lots and lots of situations. And I think it would be helpful, and we can certainly give you that breakdown.
Sure. Positions, yeah.
So, and some counties don't operate their child support. That's operated by the state. Now, that's changing next year, and all counties will have to operate child support.
Right.
But some counties at this point, like Randolph, do not operate child support.
We have 17, 18 child support staff.
Close to 20
or something like that.
Well, but they said if they brought theirs over, they bring 10. 10 to 12 is what they told me today. So, you know, again, it's not apples to apples, but we've got to look at something. So.
Sure. We'll be glad to go through our positions.
And Susan, one other thing, too, is the state mandates, according to your caseloads, how many...
In child welfare,
how many employees do you have to have?
I don't think it's mandate versus suggested.
They're standards.
No. Okay. Well, see, you can split hairs on the semantics of words all you want. If it's not mandated,
it's a standard.
Okay, standard is not mandated.
That's right. It's a standard.
You know, we can play on words all we want.
That's right. It's a standard.
It's necessary. I've worked there. It's necessary. Anything else? Can we put that back?
Yeah, let's put it back.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. All right, so now, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
I make a motion to accept the consent agenda.
I have a motion.
Second.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. All right, we're down to the commissioner comments. Any commissioner comments?
You want to do anything with this
group?
Just don't throw tomatoes.
Yeah. What? I need to sign that.
I'm an easygoing guy. If somebody don't throw tomatoes at
me. Okay, we have no commissioner comments. Are there any announcements? We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.